gold and we think the gold that we know. But the Bible says the gold is so pure, all the impurities are out of it, that the gold is see-through. Are you kidding me? That's my best life now. My best life is what the Bible says, when I can lay off this nasty, disgusting flesh with all of its issues, all of its trials. No more night terrors. No more bound in my mind. No more rolling in the bed thinking I'm going crazy. That's my best life now. Hallelujah. When I can lay off this flesh and put on my glorified body, a body that can fly and swim and do all kinds of crazy, unbelievable things that we cannot even form our minds to even imagine. This is the thing. We are not living for now. We are living for what is to come. We have this thought that there is coming an end to the world. Am I right about it? We have this great apocalypse thought, like that there's going to be zombies and, you know, all this crazy stuff, and we think that the world, the whole earth is just going to blow up or something. Somewhere in our minds, we think this kind of stuff, that the world's going to end. We saw it when they said that December 21st, the world was going to end. People were going crazy. People were literally selling all that they had and flying to Mexico because some Aztec Indian somewhere, Mayan Indian, said that it was going to happen. Why? Because we're living for this world. But if we read the Bible, that is eternal. The Bible is eternal. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. The Word became flesh and dwelt amongst us, and we beheld His glory. The Bible, the eternal Word of God, says that this earth will never be destroyed. And it says that the world will be destroyed. The earth and the world are not the same thing. The earth is the terra firma. The world is the systems and stratas of society. This earth will never be destroyed. Why? Because the New Jerusalem, the Bible says, is going to descend out of heaven, and it's going to connect with earthly Jerusalem. And the Bible says that all the nations of the world are going to flow through Jerusalem. And you know what I love about it is this. Are y'all still with me? I hope you're excited. This should be burning in your heart right now. This is eternity we're talking about. This is amazing. This is the most amazing thing I'm excited about. Preachers, our job will be done. Hi-ya-ya. Bishop, our job will be done. We can set the mics down. We can cancel all of the evangelism trainings. We can stop going out and trying to witness. It'll all be done. And the Bible says in that day, we will all sit down and be taught by Jesus. No more need to worry about false doctrine. No more need to worry about if you're twisting the script to make it fit your motive. No more need to worry about if you're trying to pimp me out of my money. No more need. Why? Because the King is going to teach us all truth. Hallelujah. I'm looking forward to that day. And that day that I set before me, that Revelation 22, is set before me. And that is why I will endure. Not just that. See, if that was it, I mean, that's pretty amazing in and of itself. But not just that. Can I tell y'all the real reason I endure through this transition? Hallelujah. Because when I finally get there, and after my mind is done being blown, I believe I'm going to fall on the floor and just stay there a while when I hit the streets of the New Jerusalem. Because I'm just going to be excited. But I believe this is the thing. The reason I cannot give up. Not only because of the people who are here. But the reason why I cannot stop fighting. I cannot act as though it's all over. Is because the Bible says that in the midst of the city. In the midst of the New Jerusalem. there is the one who is the one. There is a throne there, and seated upon that throne is Jesus. The Bible says there will be no more need for the sun, because Jesus shines brighter than the sun, and he will be the light of the city. Are you kidding me? Listen, the reason I can't stop, not only because of the great gifts that are set before me, but there is a joy that is set before me. And the book of Song of Solomon says it this way: where is the lover of my soul? I've got to have Jesus. The book of Philippians, Paul said it best. He said, listen, brothers, sisters, not as though I have already attained, neither am I already made perfect, but if that I might apprehend that for which also I have been apprehended by Christ, I run this race that is set before me. Paul said, something touched me, and it's changed my life forever. Love, the hand of love has touched me, and I have got to have this thing called Jesus. Y'all with me? I promise I'm almost done. Anybody saying hurry up? That's all right. Listen, Jesus has to be. He is the only thing able to deliver. He is the only thing strong enough. No 12-step program. No counseling demons out. No. Jesus, he is the only thing strong enough, powerful enough. Love is the only thing. Can I tell y'all something I'm tired of? And if y'all do this, please stop. Please, just do God a favor. Sit down. How they say, the young people say, now take a seat. Matter of fact, buy a stadium, have lots of seats. Thank you, Jesus. Getting up with a microphone in your hand and saying, sissies and faggots, don't get nobody saved. Don't get nobody delivered. Jumping up and calling somebody a booty bandit, that don't get nobody saved. That don't set nobody free. That don't deliver a soul. The Bible says it was with kindness, loving kindness, that he drew you. In your mess and in your sin, it was the love of God. And if the truth could be told, the reason that most people dog out other people is so that they don't have to address the reality of their own self. That's the truth about it. If we are going to win a generation to Jesus, if we are going to be overcomers, and that's what this is about. All right, if this Overcomers Network thing, Pastor Foster knows I love Pastor Foster. It brings me to tears to think about it. I love this man. Honor him. But the moment this stops being about Jesus, I promise you, you will never see me again. Why? You can keep your church. You can keep your positions and titles. You can keep all of your wonderfulness. Give me Jesus. You can take all this wonderful stuff. Just give me some sweatpants and a t-shirt as long as I can hold on to Jesus. David, so in love with the one who is the one, danced out of his clothes, so madly in love. Y'all know that woman in Song of Solomon ran through the streets saying, have you seen the lover of my soul? We say that like it's such a wonderful thing. Do you know the city people beat her? They beat her in the street, thought she was crazy. And you don't want to suffer nothing for Jesus? You have to mortify the deeds of your flesh. Salvation does not mean you are free from the struggle. Salvation does not mean, I tell people this all the time. I know so many people stuck and bound in same-sex attraction. Bound in homosexuality and lesbianism. abound in pornography. And they'll get free or whatever, you know, give it to the Lord. Next week comes, and they had a temptation. And then they just give all up. Well, I might as well just go do everything then, since I can't get it right. If I'm really delivered, then why do I still think about stuff? What? Y'all know the moment I made the decision to leave the life, Satan turned up the heat. The temptations got realer. Hallelujah. And now that I'm thinking about moving forward with life and I'm experiencing, you know, the promises of God and I'm reading the scripture and I'm finding out that marriage is honorable before the Lord, that children are an inheritance of the Lord, and I'm discovering that I want all of the promises of God. I've been in a relationship now going on a year. Hallelujah. But listen, if you're clapping as if, oh, look, proof he's delivered, keep your clap. A woman for a man coming out of homosexuality is not the proof. Psh, how degrading. Women, you all ought to be upset about that. We aren't proof. We aren't arm candy. We aren't something, a band-aid to cover up your issue. I know so many women, wonderful women, got married to men. I mean, you can't tell me you didn't know. Women, y'all know you know. You that close to a man and you can't tell? Ain't nothing that hid when you that close. You married and sleeping together and you don't know. You seen the signs, you didn't want to admit it. Because he devalued you and then you devalued you. Listen, been in a relationship for a year. Not because I feel like she's my proof. I waited until I knew in my heart that it was time. I waited until the Lord showed me by trial and error that I had a good grip on the struggle of it all, on the temptation of it all. When you have a good, look, if you just had sex last week, you ain't ready. You ain't ready. Don't mess over nobody's heart. Men who coming out of that, a woman can't compete with that. You will ruin a woman doing something like that. I know people that have done that. Got married, didn't want to address the issue, didn't want to say nothing. Year later, divorced because you went and slept with a man. Don't come crying as if she did something wrong. You was wrong on wedding day. Hallelujah. Listen. Waited. And now that I'm thinking about what does the future hold, and I don't know if anybody, can I just be honest? Can I be real about my life? I don't know what the future holds. And it's a scary thing to not know. It's scary to think I'm possibly going to share my all of me and my secrets and my issues with another, and then I have to take on their issues as well. I mean, this is a scary thing. Now, I don't have the same testimony as others. I'm not one that did both. I've never been with a woman. Even in my unsaved life, I ain't even been with a woman. Wasn't interested. Dude, can I tell my truth? I've always found women beautiful, attractive, but I honored them as if they were a prize far too worthy for me, because I was raised by a single mom who had to be strong and tough, who didn't need a man. Then when I got saved, I always hung around strong, and I can tell the truth about my story, strong black women. Can I tell my truth? I for real, this is my testimony. I had reverse racism. I honestly, besides my immediate family, I did not like white people. You put me in a room full of white people, I feel uncomfortable. I feel unsafe. I want to get out. I just, nothing to talk about. We don't relate. That's just my truth. That was me. Even as a Christian, I thought white people couldn't sing, had nothing to offer, couldn't preach, they couldn't do nothing with nothing. Put white people music on, I'm gonna look at you like, come on here. Why? I had a racist heart. I didn't think it was a problem because even the church culture embraces that. But when the Lord delivered me, amen, back to my story. So I was always around. Y'all know there are strong people in every race, but there's nothing like a strong black woman. Can I tell the? Nothing like a strong black woman. Powerful, strong, aggressive, independent. Don't need nobody. Sing songs like "All the Women Independent." Throw your hands up at me. There's nothing like a strong woman. Why? Women historically have proven time and time again, because all the way back since the Garden of Eden, when men neglected their duty and responsibility, women have always had to pick up the slack. Because a woman is a survivor. If nothing else, she will survive. Why? Because it's been happening since the Garden of Eden, when Adam decided to be a punk and let his wife talk to a serpent and be deceived. Look, there was a seduction time. It didn't happen just in a moment. I believe Eve talked to this. It took a while, worked up into it. You got to be real good and deceived when you have it so good in the garden where you can say he walks with me and he talks with me and he tells me I'm his own, and the joy we shared while we tarried there, none other shall ever know. You got to be real good and deceived to leave that. You got to be real good and deceived to have somebody tell you you'll have the knowledge of good and evil, forgetting that he gave you everything, called it good. What you need evil for when you got so much good? Hallelujah. And ever since then, men consistently have been off post, off duty, and women have picked up the slack. And so I felt as if women, in a sense, were above me. Then when I got saved, I fell in love. The first preacher I fell in love with before I even really gave my life to the Lord was Juanita Bynum. Now, y'all know Juanita Bynum is an aggressive, strong, powerful woman. And I was enamored at the fact that she could preach and run in stilettos. I was enamored. And through even my saved life, the beginning of my saved life, I always needed strong women around me because it was safe there. There was safety in the love and the honor and the respect of a nurturing woman who is like a roaring lion who will not let anything happen to her babies. That's why even in the church, spiritual homosexuality goes on all the time. Spiritual lesbianism. I don't need no man. I'm called. I can handle the anointing better than a man. Read the Bible. Now, I have no issue with women preachers, so please don't think I'm going there. I love women preachers. Down for it. It's in the book. Hallelujah. But what I'm saying is this. We constantly embrace things and then try to pray against them. You can't pray against what you embrace. You want God to deliver from homosexuality, but you won't let the men be raised up to be men. You won't let men be men, but you don't want homosexuals either. Well, then what do you want? What do you really want? I promise I'm about to wrap this up. Listen, I had thought women were above me. I had to honor them, respect them. I never thought about how to be in love with a woman, how to, you know, become one with a woman, to fulfill a covenant. Did y'all know, if for no other reason, marriage is to prepare you for eternity? Did y'all know that? God loves marriage. Why? Men, love your wives as Christ loved the church. It's a picture of what is to come, two becoming one. Hallelujah. And I found that in all of this, in me thinking about the future, thinking about eternity, preparing myself to meet the bridegroom, all of this, getting my vessel ready, preparing the oil in my lamp, trimming the wick, all of this stuff, getting ready, I have found that the heat has been turned up. And I don't know if y'all felt it, those of you that are spiritual, those who have an ear, hear what the Lord is saying. But in the last 6 months, something real crazy has been going on in the spirit for those who are in Christ. There's been a new fight, a new level of resistance to prayer, resistance to fasting, resistance to spirituality, resistance to worship. There's been a new resistance. Why? Because the end is coming soon, and if you pay attention, the darkness is getting darker. The king is getting ready to come, and the devil wants to wear you out. And God would encourage you tonight, those of you that are in this building, and he would say, listen, be not weary in well-doing. For in due time you shall reap if you faint not. Don't think that it is strange to say that sin is sin. Call it what it is. It is a good work. Hallelujah. The Bible says when you correct a man, you save his soul from hell. It is our job to cry aloud and spare not. And in my final thought, Pastor, I was saved apostolic, but I think I got this closing thing from the Kojiks. Hallelujah. And my final thought is this. We are not in a war with the world. We are not. We are not in a fight with the world. Bible says that we fight a warfare that is spiritual. That's why we have spiritual weapons. Our weapons are not carnal, but they're mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. We want to have all kinds of rallies and gun things and all of this stuff. These are not our weapons. They are the world's weapons. Hallelujah. I believe in, you know, going out in the community and making a difference and being involved in your community. We are salt and light. But remember that our weapons are spiritual. Prayer, fasting. You can go out in the street and hold a picket sign at a gay pride parade that says fags are going to hell. But you can't come to prayer meeting? It's backwards. You using a carnal weapon to fight a spiritual battle. We are called to pray. My house shall be called a house of prayer for all nations. The disciples said to Jesus, they were not enamored at his preaching. They were not enamored at miracles. They were enamored at his prayer life. They said, teach us to pray. They did not say, teach us to preach. They did not say, teach us to prophesy. They did not say, teach us to do miracles. They said, teach us to pray. Why? Everything Jesus did was an overflow of his time with the Lord. Everything Jesus did flowed out of his fasting and his prayer and his intercession and his constant denying of the flesh, his constant, not my will, but your will be done. And the Bible says that in the Garden of Gethsemane, that when Jesus said those words, let this cup pass from me, but if not, nevertheless, not my will, your will be done, the Bible says. In that moment, an angel of the Lord came and strengthened him for the journey. The angel of the Lord came to prepare him to die. The angel of the Lord came to give him enough strength to endure the persecution. The angel of the Lord came with an anointing to die. Not an anointing to write a book, an anointing to die. Hallelujah. And in his dying moments, he said, forgive them, for they know not what they do. How could Jesus, suffering the worst crucifixion that had ever taken place in the time, beaten till his flesh hung like ribbons around his feet, how could Jesus take his mind off of this pain. Long enough to put his eyes on Jesus and say, forgive them. How? Jesus on the cross facing persecution and suffering and bleeding and wheezing for you and for me. He did not pull out a miracle picket sign. Even in death, he was baptized in love. And then we in the church, we say, only God can judge me. Not so. The Bible says, to those that are in the faith, we judge you. And the Bible says that it's better to be judged now than to be judged later. We judge you not in condemnation and not beating you up, because we are not above you. We are side by side. Hallelujah. We judge you so that you can stay in the boundaries. But the Bible says to those that are without, those that are in the world, those that don't know Christ, God judges, and it says that we have no right to even formulate an opinion. I've been real dealt with lately about forming an opinion. The Lord's been dealing with me. Why? We have no right. That's God's. How are we going to stand in the Supreme Court and argue? Not saying we shouldn't do it. We should do it. Our voices should be heard as the church. Cry aloud, spare not. How are we going to cry out? You're going to hell. This is nasty. This is gross. But we can't come tell our own people that. We're fighting a war against people that the war is not with. And we're trying to make unsaved people live by saved laws. And our saved people don't live by saved laws. Let's stand all over the building so y'all can help me close. Hallelujah. If we are going to be the light of the world, if we are going to make a difference, if we are going to see a great revival, a great harvest, a great sweeping of souls, if we are going to see it, we must endure the fight, mortify the deeds of our flesh. And how do we do it? By keeping our eyes on Jesus. Why? Scripture said, I have not given you a spirit of fear so that you can be entangled again, in bondage again. But it says, I've given you the spirit of adoption whereby you can cry, Abba, Father. There was a man, preacher of the gospel in India, missionary there. And he had been captured for preaching the gospel. And they bound him up, him and his wife. And in front of his wife, they took a knife and began to peel his skin off. Alive. No pain medicine. They took a knife and began to peel his skin off. And his wife began to sing hymns. And she began to sing of the glory of the Lord as she watched her husband being murdered in front of her face. And documented, this is documented. The missionary, as his skin was being peeled from his body and all of his blood was pouring out, he began to cry out, you rid me of my mortal body, but Jesus clothes me in my glorified body. What could make a man forget the pain of a knife literally peeling the skin from his body and say something like, you rid me of my mortal body, but I put on my glory? What could do that? Only a person whose eyes have been burned with the image of Jesus. Only a person whose eyes are so set on the Lord, whose mind is so set on the Lord that he keeps them in perfect peace. Listen. All of you are on a journey, and I know many of you in here, and I know many of you are overcomers or on the journey of overcoming, and the battle is not always easy. If it was easy, everybody would do it. But this fight is fixed. And there is a way out of the fight. Because the Bible says this battle is not yours. It's the Lord's. And how we fight, how overcomers fight, how overcomers overcome is by surrendering and giving the fight to Jesus and leaning on his grace, which is sufficient, and setting our eyes on him and running the race, refusing to give up. I don't care how many times I have to fall to get there. I'm going to keep on running. I'm going to get up from this battle. I will not be condemned with the battle of my mind. I will set my eyes on Jesus. Every head bowed, every eye closed. I'm asking the musicians to come. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. If you're in this place today, Derek Dean, can you come and just play something for us? Thank you. Every head bowed, every eye closed. I'm going to ask no one to move around at this time. This is a moment of eternal significance. If you're in this place today and you would say, Carl, if I were to die today, I don't know for sure that I would spend eternity with Jesus. If you don't know that for sure, if you have any doubt about that, if there's even the question, then on the count of three, I want you to lift your hand. I want to pray for you. The Bible says that eternity is forever. It goes on and on and on. And every person will live forever. Trust and believe that. But the Bible says that to those who have surrendered, to those who are his, he will say, enter in. My children, thy good and faithful servant, to the rest that I have prepared for you. But to those who do not know him, he will say, depart from me, you worker of iniquity. I knew you not, into everlasting torment. Fire and gnashing of teeth. It's a terrible place. It's a place where you can still see God. You can still talk to God, but he cannot help you because the gulf has been fixed. If you're in this place today and you don't know for sure that you would spend eternity with Jesus, on the count of three, I want you to lift your hand. One, two, three. If that's you, everyone is saved. Everyone is saved. Amen. That's something to celebrate. Let's clap our hands. Thank you, Jesus. If you're in this place and you've been on the battle, you've been enduring the battle, but you feel like you've given up, maybe you're at that place of I'm tired. I don't want to fight no more. If you're at that place and you need prayer, I want you to come quickly. Just come if that's you. If you need prayer, hallelujah. Let's celebrate them as they come. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Come. If you've been feeling like I need a strength, I need a refreshing, I want you to come. I just need fresh strength to fight the battle, fresh strength to go. Maybe homosexuality wasn't your issue. Maybe you're here and you just need prayer. I want you to come. Come quickly. We want to pray with you. Hallelujah. I'm going to ask some of the ON leaders to come and to pray with them. Hallelujah.